I'll give you kind of a 10-minute overview of some of the things I do personally, what I do, and see if that has any interest for you. So any questions about the foundation in general? Yeah, so, you know, the place is designed for high-end continuing medical education. So this is our teleconference center. So in here, we'll do a lot of didactic, you know, training, show people, you know, presentations on how to do this procedure, how to avoid this complication, and then more than that. So we may have general reviews on stem cell treatments for, you know, different brain tumors, for example. We may have a presentation on, you know, how to fuse a broken spine, you know, with experts. And most of our presenters are high-end, you know, well-known in their field folks that come here and, you know, kind of give their expertise to the crowd. Typical scenarios, if it's a continuing medical education course that's surgically relevant, we'll have the presenters here. And then let's say it's a world-renowned surgeon who knows, you know, all there is to know about fusing the neck for people that have fractures there. So he'll give his talk in here. We'll have it presented to the group that's in the audience. We'll also disseminate that out live, you know, usually Facebook Live. We'll put it on our YouTube site so anybody can access it. It's all free. That same presenter will then go to our cadaver lab, which you'll see a little bit later on. And he'll show how to do a specific technique. You know, this is how I do a fusion of the neck. And the, you know, audience is watching here on the screens and they can see it real time. So they've heard how to do it by his presentation. They're seeing how to do it with his cadaver approach. And then everyone will go over to the lab, change out into scrubs, and then he'll show them how to do it, you know, hands on. So it's kind of the, you know, see one, do one type philosophy. And that's a very popular way of teaching. It's, you know, very on-the-spot learning, and there's some tactile involvement. There's some didactic involvement. So that paradigm for teaching is what we're kind of known for at the foundation. That answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay. What's that?
I have
another question. Yes, ma'am. Since most of our research is on anatomy, right, it's hard to see pain in the cadaver. However, I mean, in that realm, we do look at lots of, you know, specific nerves that carry pain. And if you're talking about that, we, you know, indirectly, we do look at some type of, you know, treatments for pain, but it's more anatomic, identifying a special nerve or identifying various pathways in the spinal cord, et cetera. That makes sense? Okay. So while I'm pulling this up, so I'm a clinical anatomist, and you may ask yourself, well, what is an anatomist? I'm not even sure what that is, first of all, but anatomist basically studies morphology or the parts of the body, and then the clinical part means that we study the parts of the body that have some significance to patients. Or to help physicians, help surgeons. It's a very small niche. There are, you know, not many places that you can go to that teach you how to be that. You essentially take courses that are designed for medical students early on, and then you kind of branch away from that. And so, for example, you would study, you know, histology, you'd study gross anatomy, you'd study neuroanatomy, you'd study embryology, some pathology, imaging, so radiology, and you learn, you know, parts of all of those. You learn how to teach that information. Primarily, clinical anatomists will go out and teach medical students. That's probably their main route. However, there's some that also go out and do research, which is what I do. So I've taught, but now primarily do research. And that research, again, as you know, may have gleaned, is centered around patient care. So is there something we can do by learning the anatomy of the body, and generally the gross anatomy of the body, things you can see with your eyes, and that will help patients, or will help a physician understand patients better, or will help a surgeon approach a surgery better. So I put together just like literally five little things that we've done. that'll give you an idea of some of the application. So without knowing too much, you can see that there is a problem on this slide. This is a midline slice. Does anybody know what part of the body this is from? Yeah, what part of the spine do you think that's from? Your second choice? Neck.
Yeah.
Okay. So it's the neck. So this is the base of the skull, right? And this is the upper part of the neck, the cervical spine. And do you see anything that looks funny on that slide? So these are normal spaces between the bones, right? And it looks like a gap, but there's actually the disc there, so your intervertebral discs that's there. This is the second, or part of the second cervical vertebra, this bone. And if you put that part back on it, this part's actually kind of fractured off, right? So that's a broken bone. You put that back on the side, that bone looks like a tooth, so it's called the odontoid process. Ooh, what happened, Jason? Lost, there he comes. So the odontoid is fractured in this patient. So you may hear, you know, lay people say a broken neck, right? So this is a broken neck, and that's a bad place to break your neck. So that type of injury means that you have to do some kind of surgery to fuse it. So one thing we're looking at anatomically here is why is this area break more commonly? So some people think, you know, well, maybe this area has less blood supply. Maybe there's a gradient between the blood supply. Maybe the bone is weaker here. So lots of thoughts on that. So what we're doing is looking at the details of all these little bony trabeculae that live inside the odontoid. So this, remember I told you it looks like a tooth, right? So that's the odontoid. And that thing has to be snugly stout and not move. To create the right function and not harm any part of your brainstem or spinal cord. So the understanding of its internal anatomy is very important, right? So if you can figure out, you know, why it might break at a certain spot, you can then design treatments for that, preventative things that you could do, et cetera. So we look at the internal anatomy. This is actually a new type of technology called micro CT, micro computed tomography, and it looks at internal aspects of bone like you could, you know, really never do in the past. So it's a interesting thing that we're using here in the foundation, trying to figure out what all this means. So you could make yourself rich if you could figure out the Rosetta Stone for interpreting what all those little parts mean. They're in there for a reason. And they're aligned for a reason. It's just we're not smart enough yet to figure out why they're like they are. There's some more images that show you kind of what that looks like. And if you were to look at a normal, just dry bone of the second cervical vertebra, you don't see any of this. It just looks like a little nub. So we're doing some of that. This is a regular CT. Let's see if I can get this to play. So this is a regular CT that's imaged in three dimensions, and then that means you can spin it around, et cetera. So this is your first cervical vertebra, your second cervical vertebra, third and fourth. And with this technology, you can image. This is from a cadaver. So we took a specimen from the lab, we dissected it, and then we submitted it to CT, and then they image it with radiation and come up with these beautiful pictures that allow you to spin things around, see variations, and sometimes see relationships that you can't see with the naked eye or in the lab. This, does anybody know what that is? It's close to the lungs, it's behind the lungs, so it's a spinal cord. But I know being blown up like that, it's disorienting, right? So this is the spinal cord, right down the middle, and you can see the nerves coming off the spinal cord. Kind of cool. So we've normally spinal cord is protected inside, you know, thick bone. It's in a canal of the spine, and you want it to be protected because it has a consistency of toothpaste. So you don't want anybody touching that spinal cord because if you touch toothpaste, what happens? It kind of disintegrates, right? And you don't want the spinal cord disintegrating. So it's protected very heavily by bone. And the reason for this project is we're looking at some patients, when you do neck surgery, they wake up with nerves that aren't working, that were working before the surgery. And one that does that pretty frequently is your fifth cervical spinal nerve that goes out and innervates your deltoid, right? And your deltoid helps abduct your shoulder. So some patients wake up after, you know, a remote surgery and they can't, you know, abduct their arm. So trying to figure that out, we looked at some of the movement, and most people aren't aware that the spinal cord moves when you move, right? You think of it as, you know, being kind of this static structure, but if you look at this video here, we're going to put tension on the arm. So all we did in this spinal cord, or in this specimen, is pull the arm down and watch the spinal cord real time. And you can see the whole cord moves, the nerves move, etc. This is anterior, right? So this is up at about the C5 level, C6, C7. So there's actually a lot of gross movement of the spinal cord. This is another picture, and lots of nerves that go out. I told you in the beginning, some of the courses we do are specialty courses and try to help surgeons avoid things that are in the field of a specialty surgery. So a new hot topic is doing approaches to the spine from the side, right? Instead of coming posterior, anterior, like has been done for a long time, coming from the side. And even though it's a more minimally invasive type procedure, there are new things, new anatomy that's there that gets in the way and can cause trouble. And one thing is this group of nerves that come off the spinal cord. So this is kind of in your low back here, right? And normally the surgeon doesn't have to worry about these, but now with this new approach, this anatomy is important. So this is a looking quick video here. You that way. This is the covering of the spinal cord, right? And then we see all of these intricate little nerves that come off and run out to the muscles here. And the surgeon, when he's approaching the lower spine, he can't see any of this. He's looking down a very small little hole. We try to investigate this area and give him some landmarks for avoiding these, because some of these branches that come off, for example, this little branch here, it goes to your quadriceps, and if you injure it, you can't extend your knee, which means you can't walk. So you wake up after a surgery and you can't walk, that's a bad problem. So we're trying to learn more about the area and avoid it. So those are just a few snapshots of some projects that we do. Hopefully you'll agree that most of those have some clinical application and could avoid complications or help patients, you know, that may be having an issue that that anatomy addresses. That's kind of a snapshot of what, you know, a clinical anatomist does. You'll get to hear some other folks, you know, what their specialties are. Later on in the day, we'll meet up in the lab. Have any of you done animal dissections in the past, like heart and stuff? So we have some pig heart. Have you done pig hearts? We have some pig hearts, right? And we'll, yes, sir.
So why did you want to be?
I fell into it. It's not something I, you know, sought out. Actually, I tell people the funny story that my first experience with anatomy was in high school, and there was a coach that taught the anatomy class, and, you know, that is a bad combination to begin with, and I hated it. You know, I'm like, this is the worst class. Get me out of here. I was going down the medical school pathway, and some things occurred that threw me off that pathway temporarily. And then by the time I got back on the pathway, I fell in love with anatomy. So I went down that route. Never considered it until I was like probably almost done with my undergraduate degree and had finished my degrees in biology and chemistry and was accepted to medical school, yada, yada, and got sidetracked. So looking back, it's the greatest thing I ever did. You know, it's something I enjoy and can't imagine doing anything else. So yeah, we'll go in the lab after lunchtime, and I'll show you some pig hearts, and you'll get to dissect them and ask questions. And the good thing is pig hearts, because they're, you know, mammals, they look very similar to our hearts. So I'll also show you some human hearts if you're interested, to show you the, you know, how the, one looks versus the other. And we'll go from there and answer more questions. So thanks for visiting us today, and write down all your questions, and we'll try to address them for you as we go along. Yes, ma'am. Okay.
Do you have a particular window in which you are accepting applications?
We try to be pretty general and recognize people have, you know, different lengths of time they want to stay, et cetera. And our philosophy is if you're interested in something we're doing, we'll try to make it happen that you can be involved. Sure. You want to see one more little video clip I forgot to show you? This is actually more of a teaching video. Let's see if I can... Your computer ever do that? It like opens everything that you've recently closed over the last 12 months. So we use fresh specimens in the lab here, and that is good and bad. So for research purposes, it's great because it's the closest thing you have to real human tissue. It is bad because you can't store it for a very long time because it's not embalmed. So I'm sure most of the tissues you've looked at in the past were embalmed. They had a strong formalin smell, alcohol smell. By having fresh tissue, the tissue still kind of moves and makes things move like you and I. So let's look at an image here. This is a video we did that shows how some of those muscles move in a fresh cadaveric arm.
Hi, I'm Shane Tubbs. Seattle Science Foundation.
Not that one.
And
there.
This is an anterior dissection of the right forearm in a fresh cadaveric male specimen. And we've left a lot of the fascial envelope, the antibrachial fascia, so that we can tug on some of the tissues and recreate the isolated functions of the different muscles. So we'll begin. This is the palmaris longus. And palmaris longus, we know, is a flexor of the wrist. And if we stabilize the forearm and pull on the palmaris longus, we see the flexion of the wrist very easily. This is our flexor carpi radialis. If we pull on that, we're going to see flexion of the wrist, and the wrist is going to be pulled on more on the radial side, so some radial deviation. If we come to the flexor digitorum superficialis, we'll pull on the tendons that go to the ulnar digits, and we see flexion of the intermetacarpal joints. We move around the corner to the superficialis that goes to the second and third digits, and we see those with some flexion. We'll go deeply. This is the flexor pollicis longus, so we'll pull on that and see flexion of the thumb. We'll find our flexor carpi ulnaris, and with some tension, we'll see ulnar deviation of the wrist. And collectively, if we're firing multiple muscles at one time, which anatomists sometimes forget happens more often than not, we can see a collective motion of grip and flexion of the wrist. We can even pull up a little higher, grab onto the little assistance on the biceps, and we see the biceps flexing the forearm.
All right, anyway, that's kind of a cool video to see. So it shows you some of the differences between the tissues that we use here and tissues you may be familiar with. Linda, you're on. Tinny, you're on. So I'm just warming up the stage for the better presenters here. And we'll look forward to seeing you guys in the afternoon.
Thank you.
Girl,
I'll panic.
Uh-oh. No, I'm fast.
So my name's Jenny. Did I spill my coffee? Thanks for coming out in the nice little ice storm we got going on there. So what is everybody's focus here before we kind of get started? Nursing. All right.
Still undecided.
Okay. Nailed that. Okay. So I've got a really unique history. I'll tell you what I do here, and then I'll kind of tell you how I got to it. So I'm a nurse practitioner for the neurosurgery department. Do you want me to move? Okay. For the neurosurgery department, I worked with one of the neurosurgeons here that mainly does complex spine. I manage the inpatients, meaning everyone in the hospital that's under his service, as well as the outpatient practice, which is clinic and all the excitement that comes there. I do not do the OR, and that's a whole different spectrum if you want to know how to do the OR as a nurse, very different. Most of my stuff is in the hospital or in the clinic setting. I am acute care trained, which is not something that's super familiar up here. I'm from Texas, and that's really how we do it in Texas. Either your acute care or your family practice. So that means when I was trained, I was actually trained in the ICU, and I was trained to do procedures and intubates and put in central lines, and that's what acute care nurse practitioners were used for. It's a little different here. Every state's kind of different on nurse practitioners and what they okay you to do. So how did I kind of progress through this nice little spectrum? I started out in pre-med, and after a couple years of that, decided I would switch it up, and I went in a completely different field. I got a degree in something very different. I got a degree in anthropology and specialized in archaeology. So I got to analyze dig sites, which is really cool. But you don't talk to people very much in that field, just FYI. And if you start talking to bones, people kind of get a little creeped out. Ultimately, I went back to school and I got my BSN. I was an ICU nurse for several years. ICU was high energy, high adrenaline. If you like to be running essentially most of your day, super fun, really rewarding, and had a blast. But you're a little bit limited in what you can do. Ultimately, you're still in a nursing spectrum, and if you wanted to step over that and do anything additional, you needed to go back to grad school. So I went back to grad school after I'd been in the ICU for a bit. I got my MSN in acute care as a nurse practitioner, and actually worked down in Texas in a different field for a couple years before I came up here. Now I've been up here for about 5 years. And, you know, you get to see everything. You get to see simple procedures and really healthy patients that just have little, you know, not little, but herniated discs, to these massive complex reconstructions where you're essentially standing at their bedside suturing, you know, multiple drains that you've had to take out, that kind of stuff. So very, very interesting. I have a heavy internal medicine background. The physician who actually trained me literally made me do his practice for about a year. I was free labor. He loved it. But it was really good experience. So you get to know how to manage lungs and how to manage heart and just in general overall hemodynamic stability, which is super important. Why did I kind of go down this path instead of doing medicine? Variety of reasons. I'll say my father is actually probably the main reason I didn't do medicine. But ultimately, you got to kind of do what you feel you're most passionate about. You can always switch careers, you know, later in life, but it can be a challenge. And medicine is always changing. There's always going to be a need. And, you know, everything that you guys just said, even the not knowing exactly, there's always going to be a need anywhere in medicine. You're always going to have a job as a nurse. You're always going to have a job as a physician. You're always going to have a job as a physical therapist. And the constant changes, as you guys could see with Dr. Tubbs, the things that they're researching, things are definitely, you're always going to have a need. So it's really, you kind of got to decide what you want to do and what field you want to be in. And things don't always have to be super exciting where you're running around all the time. And there's other specialties that are a little more calm than neurosurgery. But I do run quite a bit. I've broken my Fitbit, FYI. What kind of questions can I help you guys with?
You said that every state has their own like limitations or what are different, I guess, rules that
mm-hmm.
So is it just one degree that you get and it's good though for every state, or do you have to get a new one?
Degree is nation degree is nationwide, and I'm board certified, so I had to sit for a certain kind of exam, Jason running around with the microphone. I had to sit for a certain kind of exam that is nationally recognized, which there are some certifying exams in the U.S. that aren't. It's my license that changes from state to state. So if I want to go back to Texas, I actually have to have a physician that sponsors me. It's like a PA here, where you're under a physician's license. Whereas in the state of Washington, I'm an independent practitioner. I don't practice under anybody. Now, I work with a surgeon here, but I'm not under him or restricted by his license. It's purely independent. But same kind of, the rules really, I write the same kind of prescriptions. There are some states that restrict the classes of drugs that you can write as a nurse practitioner, but that's changing, becoming much more open. And then there's still some restrictions with regards to Medicare, what a nurse practitioner can write. Again, that's kind of changing as there's such a shortage, particularly in family practice, that there's just changes that are still happening. Yeah. What made me choose neurosurgery? I wanted something that was going to be kind of continuous and dynamic. I really like the ICU setting, and so I like that critical aspect where you really have to think and quickly think. And neurosurgery, you get to see some really cool stuff. I actually, when I started, it was a lot more cranial, and then I kind of transitioned over to spine. It's pretty amazing what you can do with neurosurgery, and it's just an interesting field. So anything that was really acute care related, I thought sparked my interest. And I like to do procedures, so anything that they let me do is always fun. I like the facial expression. Like, yeah.
Do you do any kind of like research or side projects on the side of just, you know, your daily jobs?
Yes, I am a little bit too active. I don't sleep much. So I do a lot of research with the fellows. I am on the research committee for Swedish, which means we review all the incoming proposals for research projects. I'm either the sub or primary investigator for about 10 to maybe, I think we're up to 12 studies now. And it can range from, you know, experimental medications for kind of paralysis from a certain kind of injury to just retrospective studies that look at how patients did after these surgeries or kind of what helped them the most. We are really starting to analyze outcomes at this point in time after spine surgery. So that means you're looking at preoperatively how functional they were from their patient perspective, and then examining afterwards how much they've improved or worsened. And it kind of gives you a spectrum of comorbidities that maybe don't have as good of outcome or certain techniques that maybe are better, that kind of thing. So, yeah, I do a lot of research. I like to write, though, so if you don't like to write. What else? Is that it?
Can someone talk after experiencing that? So, have you guys been in the OR before?
No. So I had the opportunity during SMDEP. I don't know if you've heard of SMDEP, Summer Medical Dental Education Program. So it's software professional and sophomores. I UW different sites, UW, Columbia, one application. And so, yeah, so I had the opportunity, but since I was here at UW, I gave up my opportunity for other people that were coming from across the states. The director promised me that she'll give me a spot, but it never happened. So
okay.
That's my first time.
Okay. Yeah. Awesome. Well, can't say it will compare, but this is the first time I've met you guys, so that's exciting for me. Maybe since we're a small group, I would love to just hear kind of your name and what you're hoping to study or what you're studying now.
Okay. So So my name is Michael. I'm from Yakima, Washington.
Okay. It's working now.
And my intended major is biology and physiology, and I'm trying to do physical therapy.
My name's Macy. I'm a freshman at UW, but I'm a junior in credits. I'm trying to get into nursing.
My name's Eddie. I'm a fourth year bio major at the University of Washington, and I'm pre-med.
My name is Amy, and I'm at the UW Bothell campus and majoring.
That's a great name.
Yes, definitely. And I'm majoring in biology, but still undecided what to do yet. Okay. Still exploring.
Awesome. Mm-hmm. And so I heard sophomores, and then what year did you say you were?
Junior, freshman.
Senior.
Okay, so you're all across the board, actually. Well, awesome. I'm glad to meet you guys. My name's Amy Koo. I serve as the Senior Director for International Programs for Providence Health and Services. And so you guys have already heard a bit about Providence, who Providence is. Is that correct? No?
No.
Not much? Okay, so we're all one family with Swedish, but Providence is now a 7-state healthcare system. We have 50 hospitals and about 1,000 outpatient clinics across our 7 states. We were started 160 years ago by a group of sisters that came from Montreal, and they traveled around. They actually went by boat from Montreal down the Atlantic, hit Panama, walked across Panama, came up the Pacific, went through what they call the graveyard of the Americas, like the along the ocean where the Columbia River hits the Pacific Ocean. So you can imagine that journey, how difficult it was for them. Only one of them spoke English, and they arrived in the northwest of Washington and formed what we now know today as the third largest not-for-profit healthcare system in the United States. So pretty incredible story, right? I mean, I can't imagine having ever started a hospital or a school, let alone now them having 50 hospitals and schools and all of these different clinics. So their work was really outreach to the most poor and vulnerable. And today, Providence has to continue asking ourselves, how do we maintain who we are, right? In an age where profit drives everything, where everyone is tempted to just make money off of social services, how do we as an organization maintain that core and that dedication to the poor and vulnerable? Really challenging, right? So as an organization, we have 107,000 people. So I'm curious, if you were the CEO of a very, very large system like that, how would you ensure that your hospital system maintains that dedication to the poor and vulnerable? What would you do? How would you make sure that because it depends on every employee, right? Mm-hmm. Every employee needs to hold that mission so that you really, truly commit yourselves to the needs of the most poor and vulnerable. So what would you do?
You go to the third communities, you go to the poor communities. Like, I think you mentioned going to like Guatemala or something.
Okay. You make sure your employees have exposure to those communities in need, right? Because even here at Swedish, it could be tempting to be really separate from the poor. We live in neighborhoods that might be more wealthy, and so we don't see the poor, we don't interact with them, we don't know who they are. So that's a perfect point. You have to make sure people have exposure and understand the needs. That's perfect. Anything else that you would make sure that you would do if you're the CEO?
Like, encourage employees, like, do a lot of encouragements instead of, like, it's just about anything you can encourage them to do.
Encourage them to do what?
To do what they, what they like to do, and so they don't feel like they don't want to be there.
Yeah.
Like, what they want, kind of want
to. I love that. Okay. I love that. No, I think it's hard to articulate, right? How do you make sure that people are fulfilled in their job, that they see it as maybe a calling or a vocation, that it's something that's more than just them, but it's something that's serving the world, right? It's reaching their own personal passions in service to others.
So that's something that, that Providence does quite a bit. We have what we call formation programs. And what that does is it helps people understand who is Providence, what is the history of our organization, and how do we move forward with that at the center of everything we do. So there's a lot of different ways we do that. And our international programs is one way. So I mentioned rewarding for company culture, and that's kind of jargony. but really what I'm saying when I say that is this work is just as much about how we as an organization understand who we are. And on the other hand, we're able to do incredible community good. We're able to impact populations and communities that are in need internationally. So so that's just a sense for why we do international work. And I'm going to show a short video because I think that getting a chance to see some of the communities we work with is probably more impactful than myself sharing about it. But I'll be able to kind of walk you through some of these programs after you guys watch this video. Yes.
And maybe come from there that are also like, you know, that have already gone through all that and have made, are pretty successful, that are willing, you know, to give back, you know what I'm talking about? Like, so I come from Yakima, right?
Yeah.
A low underrepresented community.
Okay.
What I want to do is, if I get my MD, back and serve that community, right?
Awesome.
So that's what drives me. But as a CEO, you know how you said, how do you get people to
yeah.
go out there without that?
Bring them into the organization.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. So one way we do that is at every hospital, we have a community board. And the community board includes representatives and people from throughout the community who are receiving services or partner with our organization. So I think what you're saying is bringing in community members that have that experience to inform how we develop programs. So that's one way we do it, is through community boards. Yeah, excellent point. Thank you. Okay, we'll go ahead and watch this video.
We're here to assemble stoves that will have external ventilation and hopefully make for a healthier home environment for the family.
Children here are at risk for actually dying of respiratory illnesses. This is our hope, that we will reduce the incidence of respiratory illnesses by putting in these stoves. We plant seeds and they grow, you hope. But you don't always see the results right away. This is the kind of work where you can see results right away.
Our heritage is based upon the Sisters of Providence, who are international and global in how they think and act. And I think it's an expectation and a hope that we will continue to find ways to be global citizens. Providence Health International is our way to share the talents of our people, the material resources we have, to benefit people in other parts of the world. But it's also a way for us to become a better organization, because our people who get involved in this kind of work, they come back as different people. Our work in Guatemala involves three areas: public health, surgical interventions, and education of health professionals. It's a unique culture in the richness of the Mayan tradition. I'm just amazed by how strong that still is in this modern day world we all live in. I think one of the things we can learn is that sense of community with which they live. The number one cause of mortality for children in Guatemala is respiratory disease. If we can make an impact on that with the stove project, that would be very exciting.
The people of Chioya are remarkably different in certain ways because of the circumstances that they're born into. They're a warm, generous, kind, complicated, fascinating people with a very rich history.
On all of our teams, there were local men. And at first, their participation was assisting. By the end of the week, they were really taking the lead in installing these stoves.
They wanted to work in solidarity with us. They wanted to be a part of improving the health of their community.
The public health side is in partnership with Medical Teams International. We had had a long-standing relationship with MTI doing other projects in Haiti, in Guatemala, and Mexico. We also know they had the in-country staff to support this, and they have the ongoing relationships with the communities. That relationship is so important when you're doing this kind of work.
It's very much a training of trainers model that we have. Our Guatemalan staff training local volunteers to implement a lot of the public health work that we do in the rural villages. It's not charity, but it's really empowering people to care for their community, to work collaboratively with volunteers to really see improvements in health. If you want to serve the poor and vulnerable, you first have to know the poor and vulnerable.
The type of poverty we see is not the same kind of poverty we see in the US, and it doesn't fit neatly, and it's disruptive. It's good to be disrupted. I think it's very important for us as people.
I didn't realize how much this was going to touch me. And the joy that you can just feel sitting in the sun in a wood hut on a dirt floor with a child that you can't even speak the same language. It's just such a simple thing.
They stay in your mind and you consider what is their reality and where are they going to be in 5, 10 years from now.
I had this very cool moment where we'd built a stove and everybody was standing around praying. I was watching the children there and kind of saying, because of this, you have a better chance. You have a slightly better chance. It was just a very cool, meaningful, spiritual moment for me.
We chose faith and practice because when it comes to providing surgery, we knew we needed to have the right partner. We chose them because they really have the infrastructure created in the country to handle such things as getting product into the country. They have the established relationships with the Ministry of Health to get all the permissions so people can practice medicine.
In Guatemala, 90% of the people have no access to healthcare. It's the fourth worst country in the world for chronic malnutrition. And so for us, we go to where they are, trying to meet the need that they have. The goal is to be the people on the ground that will be able to facilitate everything for the surgical teams and the medical teams to do what they do best. The surgical teams usually constitute about 40 people to provide the surgical care at Las Obras Sociales de Santo Armando Pedro, as well as El Área Galindo Hospital in Retao Leo.
The Guatemalan patients have such love and generosity and appreciation for what little things that we can do for them because they have so little. The need never ends. It's really a mutual care that we give them and a blessing of what they give us, because this is why we went into medicine.
The people here are from all over the country. Many of these people have been on a bus for 6 to 8 hours just to get to the clinic today and are overjoyed that they get to come face to face with us and have a hope that their problem can be improved or solved. And they tell you, I will pray for you, doctor, every day for the rest of my life and your life. And then you're just humbled by this incredible responsibility that we get to participate in.
My hope is that the faces and the experiences we've had stay alive within us and pass back through our hearts and continue to awaken us and break us open to the reality that we belong to a much larger community than the one that we see.
When we're able to use our gifts and connect our gifts with the needs in the world, exponentially, we can make a huge impact.
We belong in a way where we're called to deeper responsibility, deeper recognition, and deeper compassion. When we act out of compassion, we are in solidarity with our brothers and sisters all over the world.
Guatemala. Maybe before I jump into kind of how our programs are structured, did anything strike you, or do you have any questions about the video? Yeah. And I would say it's those types of facts and figures and information that you explore when you're traveling internationally, and you realize, wow, we have an abundance here in the United States, right? We have a lot we can share. We probably don't have to complain so much. We probably take a lot of what we have for granted. You know, those are the types of reflections that people have after experiencing something like this. So you can imagine if a group of people at a hospital together travel somewhere like Guatemala together and have this experience, one of their takeaways is, you know, how much we have here at the hospital. How can we make sure that we're sharing with the community around us? How can we make sure that we're less wasteful? All of those are the types of conversations that come up. So you can imagine how powerful that experience would be.
Yeah, just a new perspective.
Totally. A completely new perspective, right? Your paradigm has shifted. Have you guys had international experiences?
No, but if there is an opportunity, grab it.
You'll sign up first. Awesome. What we actually do, we have a lot of people at Providence who want to participate in these opportunities. We have about 350 people that participate a year and travel internationally. And I have a waiting, not, I know, I shouldn't say waiting list. We have a list of interested people who want to travel internationally of about 2,500. And in order to go on the trips, they take their own PTO, they pay about $800, they fundraise for the cost of the project itself, they participate in orientations, and then they participate in debriefing afterwards and engage in volunteer projects in their own local community. So that's a lot, right? That's a lot that people have to do, and yet they still want to participate in these trips, which I think is telling, and in part keeps me employed. So it's a really great thing.
Like looking at the 10-minute video as well, kind of connecting me back to also my roots. So my family comes from Mexico. They're from Colima. It's near, like, on the western side of Mexico. And, you know, my parents are here, but it reminds me kind of how they are over there. I haven't personally experienced it or gone over there, But I've seen pictures, and my mom's, you know, told me how they live in, you know, dirt, and they have little sheds, little houses, and just kind of crazy. Like, it reminded me a little bit about that, about how, you know, I'm just hearing my mom a little bit.
I think you can imagine many of our employees come from other countries. And so it is a powerful powerful experience, and it's wonderful for, I think, people to know that we are doing international work, because people in the United States realize that the communities perhaps that we've left back home are really struggling. So finding ways to share with what we have with those who are most in need, I think, is an important part of what it means to be an immigrant or first generation here in the United States. I certainly feel the same way. My family's from Vietnam. And we send medical supplies all around the world, including Mexico and Vietnam. And that's something that I think really resonates with many employees. So just a little bit about how the organization is structured. I know you guys are interested in learning about different positions within healthcare. So I'll share a little bit about my particular division. I sit within a division called Community Partnerships, and it includes philanthropy. So our fundraising arm of the organization, we have 50 different foundations, and each foundation fundraises for the cost of programs within our organization. So if there's someone who comes to our hospital who can't pay, then we can provide them with subsidized care through some of the funds from foundations, or for a new department. If we need a new ER, if we need a new tower of some sort, then foundations will fundraise for that. Community investment is part of that. We invested over $1 billion in charity care this year, which includes the uncompensated care, so care that we had to subsidize, or funding for community programs. The third is international, which I could talk a lot about international, so I'll talk a little bit more about that. The next one is advocacy. And advocacy is our federal affairs and state affairs arm of the organization. So you can imagine, as an organization that is in seven states and works with many people who are poor or who are in need of services, we understand what are some of the needs within our community. And so it's very important that we have an advocacy arm that can go to the government and say, we need to make sure that people who are retired have access to care. We need to make sure that the uninsured have options and have and don't go into debt when they are ill. We need to make sure that people in our country who are undocumented, even if they don't have their papers, they can still go somewhere in our state to receive care. So our advocacy arm does a lot of work. We follow all legislation that relates to healthcare, of course, which is hundreds of different bills that are going to our legislators. Another area is our mental health initiative. Providence has recently, we've been involved in mental health since the days that the sisters arrived to the Northwest, but more recently we've become more involved in mental health. And then lastly is our social responsibility, which includes human trafficking. It also includes environmental stewardship, so making sure that we're thoughtful about our carbon footprints and how we're being careful and good stewards of our resources. So in each of these areas, there are different people who work in administrative roles, and we really work closely with all the hospitals to say, how can we support you? How can we partner with you so that when we're in DC advocating, there can be a physician alongside our lobbyists that can say, yes, this is the experience that a patient had when they came to our emergency room. So I think all really exciting careers. So I think the only reason I'll add on just a little bit more there is because I think there's this sense that to make an impact in healthcare, you have to be a clinician. And I will encourage you to get a clinical degree because I think it's very important, but you don't have to. I studied political science and philosophy, two very important degrees. didn't get a job with my philosophy degree coming out of college, imagine that. But then I went back and I got my master's in public administration. And public administration, I think, was a good field for me because I was really interested in how systems work and how can you leverage resources and meet needs of other communities. Prior to coming to Providence, I worked for a really small organization. And I believe in small organizations and grassroots organizing. But you can imagine, as a small organization, it's very hard to garner the resources that you need for the needs of the communities that you're working with. Right, so I was working in Tijuana, Mexico. I was working for a very small NGO, and it was constantly a challenge to even pay the salaries of the nonprofit workers. So I made the intention and the shift to Providence, and it's been very exciting because, of course, there's resources and there's a lot of people who want to engage in this work. So if one of my partners in Guatemala says, we need three surgeons, it's like, bada bing, bada boom. It's pretty easy to find them. Unlike working for a small organization, it can be really challenging. My work in the international programs is to partner with organizations in a way that is able to impact the health of communities and in which those organizations are able to sustain that impact over a prolonged period of time. So we go in and we work, we send our surgeons, we send clinicians who can teach, we send public health volunteers and people who can work in home health infrastructure, like the stove project. But we always do that in a way that partners with local communities so that we can make sure that our work will outlast just that 1 week that we're there, right? That it will be sustained over a long period of time. And so we have five separate strategies. One is improving the health of a specific community. The second is clinical education. The third is regarding the service trips. The fourth is working with the entire organization. So thinking, how can we engage supply chain in this work? How can we engage communications and advocacy? One of the ways we engage supply chain is with medical surplus recovery. So part of my work includes a warehouse in Lacey. We collect the medical supplies and equipment from throughout the entire system. We sort it and repackage it and send it out internationally. So this year we had about $1.6 million worth of supplies that went out to local and international organizations. And that was all donations from our hospitals. So if you're ever interested in a volunteer project and would like to see that work, we have a site down in Lacey and you can see the types of supplies that we send internationally and help us sort it. And then lastly, being a voice for international health. You can imagine that all of the people who travel internationally are impacted by this work, and then they decide that they really want to make a deeper impact. And so we want to make sure that we engage all of those voices and experiences and are able to continue that work. This is the area that we're working in. This is just the areas of work that we engage in Guatemala. Some of the numbers of the people who volunteer with our program. And what we really hope to achieve in everywhere that we work is that each family we work with will have access to health education, that they will have some of the home infrastructure improvements that they need to improve the health of their community or their family, and that we'll really be able to make impact. I'm really proud to say that over the past 3 years, we've been able to reduce respiratory illness and diarrhea by half in the communities that we serve. And those are some of the leading causes of death for children under the ages of five, which is just no way to die these days, right? In global health, we call them stupid deaths because no one should have to die of diarrhea and respiratory illness. So these are some of the what I would call low-hanging fruits that we engage in with our work in Guatemala. And I know that we are already beyond time, and I'm happy to take questions if you have any, but I will turn it over so that you guys can hear a bit from Shweta. Any questions? Yeah. Go ahead, Amy. So international programs is our department. Yeah. Yeah, so it's all for employees. But if you are interested in volunteering internationally, you can email me and I can connect you with other programs. A lot of our partners internationally receive volunteers, so if you're interested, oh, I'm pushing some button, aren't I? If you're interested in volunteering with those programs, I can get you connected there. I'll leave my card with Linda. You want to volunteer? Yeah, awesome. Well, I'll leave my card, and yeah, feel free to reach out. Yeah, yeah. So our warehouse in Lacey, is where we collect the medical supplies and equipment. And so if you're interested in organizing a group from your school or from your faith community, I'll also leave my card, and you can take that and come down and visit us, and we can give you kind of a presentation on the work that we do in Guatemala too for your group. Yeah, great. Yeah, you know, we do only in that we are part of the same associations. So if there's information that we need and they have some expert that works in that area, then we'll connect with them. But we don't partner with them in Guatemala. Yeah. Okay, well, I'll be around after the presentation as well if you guys want to talk a little bit more about global health. Good luck in your careers.
Connecting our consumers to the care they need. And where are consumers looking for healthcare information? On Google. Google, Dr. Google is the biggest phenomenon that's happened in healthcare over the last 5 years. So what my team does is we help connect people to the care they need through the biggest channel they use, which is Google. So I'm gonna talk about some options of in career options in the marketing field in healthcare. So if you think about a patient's healthcare journey, health is a top five concern among patients, or not just patients, Americans, anybody who is a healthy adult is also thinking about how to keep their health in prime condition. And the three things that health consumers want today is that they want things now. They want to be empowered with the right information, so they can make their decisions, and they want us to make it easy for them. So, when you think about now, you think about Google. One of 20 searches on Google are healthcare related. That means a billion searches on Google every year are related to healthcare. And how this applies to you guys, when you guys are pre-med and undecided, nursing, is think about how your consumer is going to find you, and they're most likely going to find you through Google. And so if they're looking for stuff like coffee near me, gym near me, doctor near me, everything near me, because they're waiting until the very last moment to search for a solution and then get to it. And 77% of people start on search engines when they're looking for healthcare information. They're looking on their phones with voice search. When you ask, okay, Google, I need a hospital. Okay, Google, I need a dentist. And that's also where the work that my team does shows up Swedish and other places in the right places. So what it all means is health consumers want instant gratification, and providing content and services fast can help drive business. So what this translates into for you guys is some career choices to think about are around website development, search engine marketing. This is where you market your own services, your hospital services, through search engines like Google, and then media buying, which is essentially advertising and buying media online and offline. Then our consumers want to feel empowered. They want to have the decision they want to have the information to help them make their decisions. And consumers don't buy what their doctors say. More than 60% of our consumers like to validate the information they're hearing from their physicians. And you guys are probably too young to have had these adventures with your physicians, but more and more people go online. They look at online videos. They check out reviews on their physicians. So much like when you would buy a product from Amazon, you look at the star ratings. You read through the consumer reviews. patients are doing the exact same thing for their physicians. So as a physician or a nurse or whatever in healthcare, social is becoming just as important as anything else, as word of mouth. There were 70%, there has been a 70% growth rate on YouTube related to searches on how to do stuff. One of the most watched videos was how to calm a crying baby. So 17 million views. So YouTube videos, how to do stuff is all becoming a very big channel to connect with your consumers through. Again, what it means, health consumers are using digital resources to validate information. You have to have good content that's that makes sense to these consumers. And video can be a great tool to educate. I mean, we're on Facebook Live right now. Video can be a great tool to educate and inspire health consumers. So what it translates into for some career choices are around content marketing, copywriting, videography, graphic design, and market research. Now, I know the four of you are not in the field, in the market for stuff like this, but whatever you do end up doing, content is going to be the fuel that drives business for you when you're out there in your careers. Good stories is what will be the fuel. And lastly, health consumers want an easy experience. Don't make me think. Keep it simple. The attention span of consumers is shrinking from 12 seconds to 8 seconds. I mean, 8 seconds is actually optimistic for me. I don't pay attention for more than 5 seconds. If it doesn't make sense, I move on. 77% of consumers switch if a mobile site or an app doesn't give them what they're looking for. This is one of our products that we offer is telehealth visits. So this is where you can see a physician through a phone or a tablet. So you don't have to leave home. You do it from home. They can send in prescriptions if you need it. When we develop products like this, as we become more and more innovative in the delivery of healthcare, ease of use is a basic foundation upon which we have to build anything that we want to do. Again, what it means, online and offline experiences. So what you do on the hospital website and then what happens to you when you walk into a hospital needs to be frictionless. It needs to flow through without making people think. Industry disruptors, the way people have disrupted different industries has been by making things more easier. The only reason Uber is as successful as it is it took out the payment. The step around payment from a taxi experience. You guys all, have you guys ever taken a taxi? Okay, no. I'm surprised that you guys have. No, I said taxi. I know everyone's probably taken an Uber. Yeah.
It's different. You wouldn't know if you didn't have to
yeah.
hail a taxi.
Yeah. Yeah. Right. Exactly. And so making it easy, some of the career choices in healthcare is around product management. This is where you build cool stuff. You can be an engineer. Here's one of the things that we're building. So I'm part of this really awesome group called Digital and Innovation at Providence. We build innovative products for our consumers. One of the things that they're working on there is around building this telehealth cart in a box, which is essentially a whole telehealth offering that fits inside a box and can be taken anywhere. So think about the uses for this product. They can go on these international missions, and there's all sorts of amazingness that can come from that. So a person who's sitting in rural Iowa who doesn't have access to a world-class neurosurgeon can connect through a telehealth offering like that and get access to the best care possible. So it's our product managers and our software and hardware engineers who build that stuff. App development, like the preponderance of apps is staggering. There's an app for everything. And as you think about making your consumers' lives easier, think of the next big app that can make it easier. Data science and machine learning is where you use your consumers' or patients' data, figure out what can you do to make things better for them. So there's propensity models that can be created, looking at data and predicting what's next for this patient. Lots of different options here. And I think that's it for me. Yes. So my bachelor's degree was in finance. I realized I didn't like numbers that much. So then I got a master's degree in information technology management. So what it does is it bridges the gap between IT and business, because people who are in business don't speak IT, people in IT don't speak business, and so this kind of bridges the gap. And so digital marketing is a very interesting, it's a very interesting field because it uses both. It needs you to understand the business and then how to use the digital universe to make your business grow.
Human-centered design engineer.
Oh, cool.
And he does a lot of, like, what you kind of mentioned reminded me of him because he, like, makes projects and apps, and he wants to get, like, personal consumer interaction.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what the main focus is. So how does the consumer connect easily with the apps that they make, you know, and that kind of make things visually aesthetic, right? So,
mm-hmm.
you know, it's kind of interesting. That.
Yeah, and healthcare is the perfect world to do that stuff. The awesome thing about healthcare is every single one of us is a consumer. Like, so everyone has experienced it at some point. Everyone has ideas about how to make it better. And we need to make it better. It's painful right now. Any other questions?
Thank you so much.
Absolutely.
Thank you.